Hallelujah. You're welcome to another exciting time again on television. And I sure do know God is going to bless us today. I'd like us to get into His presence deeper than we've ever done before. Shall we pray together? Gracious and everlasting Father, another hour has come to have fellowship with you. We pray today that you will outpour grace unto us and make us, Lord, anew, refreshed in thy presence by thy spirit. In Jesus' most holy name we have prayed. Amen. Hallelujah. I'll be speaking briefly, sharing with us on the subject, subtle pride. Subtle pride. Not the loud one. Not that is so cocky and so visible. But that is silent and so hidden somehow that makes a person feel he's humble, not knowing that actually he is proud, thinking he is humble. That's what I want to share with us now, so that we'll all be guided. Because humility in some persons translates to pride. You know, I'm a very humble man. And you're saying you're humble, but you're manifesting pride. Is that your humility makes you blindfolded to the extent that you don't even want to listen to what someone else is saying. You believe in yourself and that's all. That's subtle pride. Very deceptive. What is pride? It's an excessive appreciation of oneself or one's worth. One's virtue. You so much esteem yourself by virtue of what you think you know or who you think you are, and you see every other person as nobody. But you do not go about shouting, "I'm proud." It is an inordinate self-esteem that places you in your mind above every other. But you tell yourself, you know, I'm a very humble person. In that you are a very humble person, you have placed yourself higher than every other person. We need to be watchful and guide against that kind of dangerous pride, because that one kills and makes one find himself in a state that people wouldn't even want to advise or talk to him anymore, because he has seen himself to be better, bigger, more knowledgeable, but silent than any other person. Turn with me in your Bible to Proverbs chapter 16, verse 18. It says, pride goes before destruction. Pride goeth before a fall. And a haughty spirit before a fall. Better to be of a humble spirit with the lowly than to divide the spoil with the proud. I'm not saying that one should not have esteem for himself. As a matter of fact, it is good to know who you are and carry yourself in that esteem. That makes you stand out. Because when you don't even know yourself, if you don't have regard for yourself, nobody will value you. I'm not talking about that. There must be self-esteem, but an excessive one. An inordinate one is the dangerous one I'm talking about. The Bible says in the book of 1 John, if you go there with me, chapter 4, let's look at what it says in verse 1. 1 John chapter 4, verse 1. It says, "Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits whether they are of God. Because many false prophets have gone into the world." The Lord enjoins us through Apostle John to test all spirits. So I ought to test my spirit. I ought to check myself, do a self-check to know whether I am on course. I might be an authority in scripture, quote and unquote. I might know the scripture because nobody is an absolute authority. But that does not mean that I become inapproachable. Nobody can talk to me. Whatever anybody is preaching, you just, you believe you can do better. That's pride, that's arrogance, silent and subtle one. Test all spirits. Do you have the spirit that embraces what is new and what is right? Are you teachable? Do you have a spirit that welcomes people? Yes, you can welcome. But let there be a guard in you. Because the scripture says, test the spirits. Check to know whether they are of God or not. Pride has destroyed so many in a bid to stand in what you think you know. You have shut the doors of fellowship. You have shut the doors of learning. You have shut the doors of improving on what you know because you believe you know so much. Let's hear what Apostle Paul says, reading from King James Version in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 Corinthians chapter, okay, not directly there. Let's just say 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 10. What is said there? 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 10. It says, but God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God. It is the Spirit that searches the deep things of God. So as you test the Spirit, allow God to guide you into deeper revelations on matters. Not you building a wall and edging out people from you because you think you have arrived. Apostle Paul was conscious of the depths of revelation, and he spoke of himself in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, reading from verse 6, knowing the depth of revelation God has given to him, that if he is not careful, he will end up seeing himself more superior to every other apostle. He spoke of himself and he said, for though I would desire to glory, I shall not be a fool, for I will say the truth. But now I forbear, lest any man should think of me above that which he seeth me to be. I check myself so that people will not think of me more than who I truly am. Or that he heareth of me. More than what he seeth me to be, or more than what he's hearing of me. Oh, Apostle Paul, wonderful. A man of great revelation. You have had so much of it. He said, I forbear. I check myself so that people will not think so much of me. Now in verse 7 it says, unless I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations that were given to me, that was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan, to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. He said, he discovered that this infirmity that came upon his flesh, that he besought the Lord thrice for healing over, did not go. And the Lord sent that as a check to him, to humble him. This is a man that will lay hands on the sick and the sick will recover. A man whose apron brought wondrous signs and wonders and miracles. The dead are raised back to life. All manner of despicable and unbelievable miracles happened in his ministry. But he couldn't heal himself. It's like the saying that goes, physician, heal thyself. And he said, a messenger of Satan was sent to buffet him. He said, that was given to me a thorn in the flesh, so that I wouldn't think of myself so much more than I should think of myself. He guarded against the subtlety of high self-esteem beyond measure, subtle pride. And he could listen to others. He could talk to others. He could feel the pain of others. He never lived larger than life. He saw himself, yes, as a man saved by grace. Right there where you are hearing the sound of my voice. Do you see yourself so much above your subjects, your followers, your congregation, your other ranks in the office because you're their boss and you feel you earned it by virtue of your hard work. No, it's God. Guard against pride. For pride goeth before the fall. In that, my brother, take it easy. You believe you're already taking it easy. If not, that I'm careful, how would I have gotten here? The enemy is sowing a seed that will not allow you open up for instruction and for guidance. What does this dangerous pride do to a man? It hinders a man from seeking after God because you believe that you already know enough. You believe you have heard so much of the messages you have preached in every country of the world. You are a pastor. You've got grace. Miracles have happened in your ministry. And this and that. So what do I need again? The Bible tells us in Psalms chapter 10 and verse 4. The wicked through the pride of his countenance will not seek after God. But is not. God is not in all his thoughts. His ways are always grievous. The wicked, through the pride of his countenance, will not seek after God. So pride makes a man not to seek after God. It keeps you larger than everybody. It makes you believe you are there. You know, I'm a humble man, and you shout it everywhere, you're proud. Humility does not announce itself. It's a virtue that manifests. Virtues, as a matter of fact, manifest. Pride is sin. Humility is sin. But when you become so humble that you take glory in your humility, you're gradually becoming proud. Be careful. So pride hinders a man from seeking after God. Pride brings shame to a man. It will end up disgracing you. In Proverbs chapter 11 and verse 2, when pride cometh, then cometh shame. But with the lowly is wisdom. When you're humble, wisdom comes. For the meek shall inherit the earth. It brings shame ultimately. It brings a man low. If you go further to chapter 29 of that same Proverbs, and we look at verse 23, the word of God says there, a man's pride shall bring him low, but honor shall uphold the humble in spirit. Such test all spirits and allow God, who by himself searches and tries all spirit, to go through you, through your spirit, to discern what is operating in you. Oh, hallelujah. Paul was consciously dealing with himself. He said, I bring myself daily under subjection. I bring myself daily under subjection. Pride, my brother, my sister, ends up driving people away from you. Now, when a man sees you apparently doing something wrong, he'll just keep quiet. He said, Naim Sabi now. I think she Sabi everything. Let her go ahead. May we search the deep things of God. May we humble ourselves and allow truth to penetrate through us. You can learn from the big, you can learn from the mighty, from the low, from whosoever and whatsoever class. That's why the Bible says, go to the ants and learn. Go to the locusts, to the cronies. Learn from everything. The wisdom of Solomon was so all-encompassing that he learned from everything that existed on earth. My dear, let's guard against pride. Let's guard against that subtle one that exists in a man that is humble and ends up turning his humility to pride. I pray that the Lord will make us humble before him. For God resisted the proud and gives grace to the humble. Let his grace be with us. And so let's make it a prayer this moment and say, Lord, grant me the grace to be humble. Grant me the grace to walk in simplicity of heart and spirit. Grant me the grace to seek after you and to forget whatever depths of revelation and seek for something more. Oh, like Paul said, forgetting the things and reaching out to those things ahead of me. Make it your prayer this moment and say, Father, teach me to number my days that I might incline my ears to wisdom. Make it a prayer that the Lord will break and take away from you every element of pride, every element of arrogance, every element that makes you inapproachable, that makes you unteachable, that makes you believe that you are just complete and you don't need anything more. Pray and say, Father, create in me a heart of humility and grant unto me the heart of the simple, that I will open up to new things of the Spirit. And the Lord himself will cause grace to be available for you in the name of our risen Christ. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for the listeners and the viewers that have heard this word and have made a prayer from the depth of their heart. I ask this moment, as we join faith together, that you will, by your power, circumcise our heart and take out of us every element of pride and bring us to the side of the cross. Thou who remained God and chose to become man to save man and die the death, the worst death on the cross, just to save man. Lord, you paid the highest price of humility. I pray that we'll be humble this day and that we will submit ourselves more to your grace, that you will wrought your fullness in us. But I save someone today hearing the sound of my voice. Do something new in the heart of that listener. Do something new that we will walk with you and find grace to carry us through this journey of life. We rebuke the power of pride. We break this hold and this grip of our life. And we say we are new in you. Thank you, gracious Lord, for you will receive us unto yourself. Because you resist the proud and you give grace to the humble. Thank you, Father. You said, if my people called after me shall humble themselves and seek my face, then I'll turn and I'll look unto them and heal the land. Give unto them greater than they've ever asked of. This is our prayer, dear Lord. And we know it's done unto us. In the most excellent name of Jesus Christ, we have prayed. Amen. God loves you, and so do I. God bless you.